Yes, my dear friends. So let's start discussion about a very, very interesting and wonderful concept. That is a concept of e-way bill, which is something which is extremely popular and one of the finest concept, not just from an examination standpoint, but also from a very practical standpoint. It is very important that you guys should definitely have some great clarity of thought on this wonderful concept called concept of e-way bill, which is something very practical and very important. And there have been a lot of cases where people fail, people forget to generate e-way bill and have been facing huge consequences. And the consequences are not normal. The officer is intercepting the vehicle, stopping the vehicle and asking the person to pay the penalty, only then take the goods. If not, the goods will be stopped then and there itself. Clear, my dear friends? Once upon a time, the story of the Government of India was very simple, that every state they put some borders and their check post were there where they used to stop and check the goods very clearly. But now under GST law, one interesting concept what they brought is the unique concept of e-way bill. Otherwise, whenever any person who causes movement of goods, who causes movement of goods of consignment value, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, what is the language, sir? Any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value greater than 50,000, any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value greater than 50,000 should. When I say should, that means what? It is mandatory, it's not an option. Should generate definitely something called e-way bill. In form GST EWB 01. Which form, my dear friends? In a form called GST EWB 01. In that form, e-way bill needs to be generated. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value greater than 50,000 should definitely generate e-way bill in a form called GST EWB-01. And let me tell you, we have got one specific website for generation of e-way bill. And the website for generation of e-way bill is www.ewaybillgst.gov.in. I repeat again, what is the website name, my dear friends? www.ewaybillgst.gov.in. Now, let me show you that website so that you get a complete clarity of thought. ewaybill.gst.gov.in. This is the website for the purpose of generation of e-waybill, and we can see very clearly here there is a login option here through which every person have to generate e-waybill, they'll click that login, enter their user ID and password. And by any chance, if you don't have user ID password, you can create a user ID password here. Clear, my dear friends? And you can see here registration tab, you have something called e-way bill registration. I hope you are able to see there. E-way bill registration, other line, enrollment for what? Transporter, or e-way bill for citizens. Citizens basically means somebody who is an unregistered person. Even he can get registration done on the e-way bill portal. Getting clarity, my dear friends? And what is the website for generation of e-way bill? www.ewaybillgst.gov.in. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Good. Come on, going back to the discussion, the first point what I wrote very clearly is that, what, my dear friends, any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value more than 50,000, they should generate e-way bill in a form called GST EWB-01. Which form they'll generate, my dear friends? They'll generate in a form called GST EWB-01. And the validity for, website for generation of e-way bill is www.ewaybillgst.gov.in. Getting clarity by difference? Come on, sir. Who has to generate E way bill? Any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value more than what, my difference? 50,000 should generate E way bill. Clear my difference? Now, next very, very interesting point I'll tell you. Kindly please listen, my difference. Movement of goods. Come on, my difference. What is the line I wrote there, my difference? Movement of goods. Movement of goods can be. Movement of goods can be in relation to supply. Movement of goods can be in relation to what, sir? Supply. Or for reasons other than supply. That means even though transaction is not a supply, still you have to generate E way bill. It is not that E way bill will generate only if the transaction is supply. That means even if the transaction is not a supply, still you have to generate an E way bill. Or inward supply from an unregistered person. I repeat one more time. Inward supply from what person, my dear friends? Inward supply from an unregistered person. That means if supplier is unregistered person and receiver is a registered person. One more time I repeat, sir. If supplier is an unregistered person, supplier is an unregistered person and receiver is a registered person, then receiver must generate E way bill. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Speak out, sir. And very, 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 very interesting point is that E way bill should be generated. E way bill should be generated. I repeat one more time. E way bill should be generated. E way bill should be what, my dear friends? Generated prior to commencement of movement of goods. It is not that after commencement of movement of goods you will generate an E way bill. Sir, I have seen one practical case for this. Let me tell you that. Sir, first of all, we have got one wonderful section called section 129 in CGST Act, which talks about penalties in case of detention, seizure and release of goods and conveyance in transit. Whenever goods are being transported without proper documents or without an E way bill, then officer will stop the vehicle and check the goods. And if E way bill is not there, practically they are imposing a penalty. And very clearly, section 129 says that. I repeat one more time. Very clearly, section 129 says that if the owner comes forward, who comes forward, sir? If the owner comes forward, then penalty is 100% of tax. I repeat one more time. If the owner comes forward, then penalty is 100% of tax. And by any chance, if the owner doesn't come forward, then penalty is 50% of value. And practically, obviously, owner will come forward to pay the penalty because ultimately he won the goods. And if owner comes forward, my dear friends, penalty is straight away. I repeat one more time. If owner comes forward, penalty is straight away 100% of tax. I repeat one more time, friends. If owner comes forward, penalty is straight away 100% of tax. And if owner doesn't come forward, then penalty is 50% of value. And practically, I have seen one case, my dear friends. One of my client was making a movement of goods. Goods were going from one place to another place and there was E way bill was not generated. So during the course of transit, GST officer stopped the conveyance and asked for E way bill. This man, in simple words, he told, sir, we forgot generating E way bill. We'll generate right now and give it to you in 2 minutes. So he called somebody in the office and told, generate E way bill in the website and send the document to somebody. So that man got generated an E way bill in the website and brought it. And what the officer told very clearly is that I stopped the vehicle at 6:30 PM in the evening. I stopped the vehicle at 6:30 PM in the evening and the E way bill generation time is 6:45 in the evening. That means very clearly that E way bill is not generated prior to commencement of movement of goods. E way bill is generated when the goods were in transit and when I stopped the conveyance, that time you generated E way bill. So very clearly they told this E way bill is not valid. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Speak out, sir. Friends, say something, my dear friends. Come on. Very, very interesting point. So any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value more than 50,000 should definitely generate e-way bill in a form called GST EWB 01, and the website for generation of e-way bill is www.ewaybillgst.gov.in, and the movement of goods can be in relation to supply or for reasons other than supply, or inward supply from what person? Unregistered person. That means very clearly that if supplier is unregistered person and receiver is a registered person, then receiver will generate e-way bill. And next point, what I wrote very clearly is that e-way bill should be generated prior to commencement of movement of goods. I want to underline that interesting word called prior to commencement of movement of goods. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Now, one very, very interesting point I'll ask you, think properly and tell me. Then I'll give some time for you to write that concept also. Listen. Sir, let's say there is one person called Mr. X. He is making movement of goods. He is making movement of goods of value 45,000 and GST at the rate of 18%. GST at what rate, sir? 18%. Come on, my dear friends. 45,000 into 18% is the GST component. Come on, my dear friends. 45,000 into 18% GST component, 8,100. Correct, friends? Come on, going back. So basically, the value of the supply is 45,000. On that GST at the rate of 18%, which was coming to around 8,100. And total comes to 53,100. Now my question is, should Mr. X generate e-way bill? That is the question what I have got. Come on, my dear friends. My question is, what, my dear friends? Should X generate e-way bill? That is an interesting question. What I am asking very clearly, should he generate e-way bill? Obviously, our brain will tell, sir, definitely answer is no, because value is less than 50,000. But let me tell you very clearly, the answer is yes, my dear friends. He should generate e-way bill, because very clearly they told in the law, consignment value shall be value as per section 15. And section 15 always says, talks about something called value of supply. Value as per section 15, declared in invoice or bill of supply or delivery challan. Sir, invoice is a document given evidencing movement of goods. It's a document to evidence tax invoice, and bill of supply is given by composition supplier or in case where we are supplying exempted goods. Delivery challan is in case of principal to job worker. Otherwise, a transaction which is not a supply, for that we give a delivery challan. Consignment value shall be value as per section 15, declared in the invoice or bill of supply or delivery challan, and includes, and what, my dear friends? Includes CGST or SGST or UTGST or IGST and also compensation cess. We all know that there is something called GST compensation cess levied on some product, like levied on some products like tobacco products, motor car. On some products, government is imposing GST compensation cess, and that cess is being imposed for the, and they are using that money for the purpose of compensating the states who have lost revenue on account of introduction of GST. I repeat one more time, the compensation cess amount is being used for the purpose of compensating the revenue of the states who have lost revenue on account of introduction of GST. Come on, my dear friends. Consignment value shall be value as per section 15, declared in the invoice or bill of supply and or delivery challan, and include CGST or SGST or UTGST or IGST, and definitely, what, my dear friends? Compensation cess, and excludes I repeat one more time, my dear friends, and excludes. And what, my dear friends? Excludes value of exempt supply, where invoice consists of, where invoice consists of both taxable and exempted. Come on, my dear friends, very, very interesting language, sir. Invoice consists of both taxable and exempted. So it excludes value of what, my dear friends? Exempt supply, where invoices consist of both taxable as well as what, my dear friends? Exempt supply. Getting clarity, my dear friends? So very clearly, in my particular case, my answer is yes, because very clearly, invoice value, we will see including GST. So whenever we talk about the word called consignment value always refers to value including GST. That's a very clear cut point. Consignment value always covers value including what, my dear friends? GST. Very, very interesting point, my dear friends. And it actually makes a lot of sense. Clear, my dear friends? Come on. See the first point. Before I move forward, let's discuss once again what we have done so far. What is the concept we started our discussion about? We started our discussion about a beautiful concept called e-way bill. What the first point we wrote? Any person who causes movement of goods of consignment value greater than 50,000, they should generate e-way bill in a form called GST EWB01. And the website for generation of e-way bill is www.gst.ewaybillgst.gov.in. And the movement of goods can be in relation to supply or for reasons other than supply, or inward supply from what person? Unregistered person. Now, what is the significance of this word called inward supply from unregistered person? If supplier is unregistered person, I repeat one more time, if supplier is unregistered person and receiver is a registered person, then receiver can generate e-way bill. In other words, receiver should generate e-way bill, and e-way bill should be generated always prior to commencement of movement of goods. I'll just wait for 2 minutes so that you guys can take these points. Kindly please don't relax. I really want you to write down these points. There are still a lot more interesting points to talk in this fantastic concept called e-way bill, which is generally coming in exam for 4 marks at our CA final level. And all said and done, keeping the 4 mark story aside, this is something very practical which students should know very clearly about the concept of what is e-way bill all about. Come on, kindly please take it. I'll just wait for 2 minutes for you to take down these points. So very clear cut point to be observed and kept in mind is that only that person will generate e-way bill who is causing movement of goods of consignment value greater than 50,000, and they'll generate e-way bill in a form called GST EWB01. And the website for generation of e-way bill is www.ewaybillgst.gov.in. Come on, take it. Done. Can I scroll further? Done. Let me scroll. I want you to take this point. Very interesting, because this example gives you clarity of thought on what is the meaning of that word called consignment value. And it is very important that you should know what is the meaning of consignment value. Come on, friends, please take it. Take it, come on. Clear, friends? Come on. So, friends, very clear, my dear friends. E-Label is a mandatory document to be generated by any person causing movement of goods of consignment value greater than 50,000. Now, one very, 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 very special point I'll discuss with you. Kindly please concentrate, my dear friends. Now, an interesting point is that cases where e-Label is mandatory. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Cases where e-Label is mandatory, even though consignment value is less than 50,000. Come on, my dear friends. I'm talking about a special case called cases where e-Label is mandatory. Come on, my dear friends. What is that we are talking, sir? Cases where e-Label is mandatory, even though consignment value is less than 50,000. That means generally we told very clearly that e-Label is a mandatory document only when consignment value is more than 50,000. Now, some special case I'm talking with you, that is a cases where e-Label is mandatory, even though consignment value is less than 50,000. That is number one, interstate. I repeat one more time, my dear friends, interstate transfer of goods by principal to job worker. Friends, I'm sure we all know what is the meaning of this word called job worker. Job worker is somebody to whom we give the materials and ask him to manufacture the finished product. And classic example for the job worker is, let's say I go to a tailor and I give a shirt cloth piece and ask him to stitch a shirt and give it back to me. I repeat one more time. I go to a tailor and give a shirt cloth piece to him and ask him to stitch the shirt and give it back to me. What that tailor is doing is called technically job work. So what is that we are talking here is interstate. What state that to? Interstate transfer of goods by principal to job worker. An interesting point to be noted is that e-Label should be generated I repeat one more time. What is the language, sir? E-Label should be generated either by the principal. Come on, my dear friends. E-Label should be generated either by the principal or the job worker if registered. Come on, my dear friends. E-Label should be generated either by the principal or the job worker if the job worker is what person? Registered person. Very, very interesting point. Second point, which is extremely important, and I hope you recollect your concept of registration, my dear friends. Sir, in registration, I told you one very interesting point. In section 24, there is one topic called compulsory registration. Otherwise, where registration is mandatory irrespective of aggregate turnover. There is one point which says interstate taxable supply of goods. If it's interstate taxable supply of services, then registration is not mandatory. But if there is an interstate taxable supply of goods, then registration is mandatory. In this context, the important point what I told you there very clearly is that in general, interstate taxable supply of goods, registration is mandatory. However, in case of handicraft goods, I repeat one more time. However, in case of handicraft goods, registration is not mandatory unless aggregate turnover exceeds threshold limit. Like that, we learned very clearly. But now, one point very clear is that interstate transfer of handicraft goods. By a person exempted from obtaining registration. Come on, my dear friends. An interesting language, sir. What is that language, my dear friends? Interstate transfer of handicraft goods by a person exempted from obtaining registration. Because whenever you are doing interstate taxable supply of handicraft goods, registration is not mandatory. unless turnover exceeds threshold limit, even though registration is not mandatory, still you have to generate e-label, even though consignment value does not exceed 50,000. Sir, these two cases are those cases. I repeat one more time. These two cases are those cases where generating e-label is mandatory, where generating e-label is mandatory, even though consignment value is less than 50,000. Generally, e-label is mandatory only when consignment value is more than 50,000. But these two cases, e-label is mandatory even though consignment value is less than 50,000. Come on, friends, please write down. I'll wait for 2 minutes for you. Please do write. Please take it, come on. So friends, in general, when e-label is mandatory, sir, in general, e-label is mandatory only when consignment value is more than 50,000. But an interesting point which we just discussed, that is very clearly that there are two cases where e-label is mandatory even though consignment value is less than 50,000. That is number one, intrastate transfer of goods by principal to job worker. Number two, intrastate transfer of handicraft goods by a person exempted from obtaining registration. Come on, friends, take these 2 points very clearly. Can I proceed and move forward? Done. Let me proceed and move forward, my dear friends. Sir, whenever I talk about this form called GST EWB01, that is the form for generating e-label, my dear friends, this particular form contains two parts, my dear friends, part A and part B. I repeat one more time, it contains part A and part B. Now, part A contains GSTIN of supplier and recipient. GSTIN of what, sir? Supplier and recipient. Then, place of dispatch, where we want to send, my dear friends, place of dispatch, and of course, delivery also. Place of dispatch and delivery. And obviously, common sense point, we will indicate something called PIN code, postal index number code, that is very common, my dear friends, and nature of document. And when I say nature of document, is it a invoice or is it a bill of supply or is it a delivery challan? Clear, my difference? Nature of document. Nature of document along with document number, my dear friends. Nature of document along with document number. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Then date value of the goods. Obviously, my dear friends, the concept of e-label is only in case of goods, not in case of services. Common sense point. And the fundamental idea of e-label is very clear, that government wants to track movement of goods. That is the whole idea there. Value of goods. Then HSN code. Friends, by the way, what is HSN code, my dear friends? HSN code stands for Harmonized System of Nomenclature, which is clearly an 8-digit code. HSN stands for Harmonized System of Nomenclature, which is an 8-digit code. Clear, my dear friends? Done. Next line. Reason for transportation. When I say reason for transportation, is it a supply or is it not a supply? Clear, my dear friends? Now, an interesting point what I'll tell you is that part A is to be filled by person causing movement of goods. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Part A is to be filled by the person causing movement of goods. So that person who is undertaking movement of goods, he will generate something called Part A. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Now, very interesting point, my dear friends. Part B contains transport details. I repeat one more time. Part B contains what, my dear friends? Transport details. Otherwise, it basically contains the transport document number. Otherwise, something like lorry receipt number, airway bill number, or railway receipt number, and all. Clear, my dear friends? And very interesting point, my dear friends. Vehicle number. In case of transport of goods by road, and generally it is very common that we hand over our goods to somebody called GTA, who is a goods transport agency, and he will undertake the movement of goods. Correct, my dear friends? Speak out, sir. And very interesting point to be kept in mind is that part B needs to be filled by the person who is transporting the goods. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Part A needs to be filled by the person who is causing movement of goods, and Part B needs to be filled by the person who is transporting the goods. So for example, if Shivateja is the supplier and you are the recipient and I am sending goods to you, let's say I am sending goods in my own vehicle. If I am sending goods in my own vehicle, I will only fill Part A, I will only fill Part B. But imagine a case where if I am sending goods through a third party transporter, I will fill details in Part A, and the details of the Part B are filled by transporter. Obviously, because it's a common sense point, how will I know what will be the vehicle number in which transporter will send the goods? Obviously, I'll not know in which lorry vehicle or in which lorry number he will send the goods. So Part A will be filled by Shivateja, and Part B will be filled by the transporter. But if the goods are going in my own vehicle, Part A, Part B, both I will only fill. Getting clarity, friends? Very, very interesting and important point. I'll just wait for a minute. Kindly please take this point as to what is Part A, what is Part B, and who will fill Part A, who will fill Part B. Write down this point, come on. Excellent, very interesting and important points. Please write down. Please take it, come on. Come on, friends, please write down. Part A is to be filled by the person who is causing movement of goods. And obviously, which person? The person is nothing but registered person. No doubt about it. Because the provisions of EVA bill only applies only to a registered person. Registered person causing movement of goods. And Part B is to be filled by person who is transporting the goods. Now, one special point, what I'll tell you very clearly is that, kindly please listen, my dear friends. Information in Part A, information in what, my dear friends? Part A may be furnished information in part A may be furnished by transporter. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Information in part A may be furnished by transporter on. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Information in part A may be furnished by the transporter on an authorization. On an authorization received from registered person. Clear, my dear friends? Speak out. Or by an e-commerce operator or courier agency. E-commerce operator or what, my dear friends? Courier agency. On authorization received. An authorization, what, my dear friends? Received from consignor. And consignor is obviously who sent in the goods. Information in part A may be furnished by the transporter on an authorization. One more time I repeat. Information in part A may be furnished by the transporter on an authorization received from whom, my dear friends? On an authorization received from registered person or by e-commerce operator or courier agency. E-commerce operator or courier agency. On an authorization received from consignor. Come on, please write this point. Very clearly, very important. And my dear friends, let me tell you very clearly, all these points what we are discussing is all given by one wonderful rule called Rule 138. Rule 138 only talks about everything related to e-way bill. Very, very important point. That's it. I hope you have taken the special point. Finished that special point, friends. That's it. So, friends, we got some fair idea of what e-way bill is all about, and there are still a lot more points to talk in e-way bill. Let's discuss that now. Come on, friends. Next point. Story is not yet done. We still should know very clearly some more interesting points in this concept of e-way bill. Extremely important, guys. Come on, please concentrate. Now, listen. If the goods are transported through railways, my dear friends, I repeat one more time, if the goods are transported through what, my dear friends? Railways. If the goods are transported through railways, then there is no requirement to carry the e-way bill. There is no requirement to carry the e-way bill along with goods. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. There is no requirement to carry the e-way bill along with goods. But railways must carry invoice or bill of supply or delivery challan. Friends, one point you have to understand is that I wrote the word, if the goods are transported to railways, there is no requirement to carry the e-way bill along with the goods, but e-way bill should be generated. I never told there is no need to generate e-way bill. E-way bill should be generated, but there is no requirement to carry the e-way bill along with the goods in case of railways. Clear, my dear friends? Speak out now. Next line. At the time of delivery, comma, e-variable generated, e-variable, what my difference, generated for moment, e-variable generated for moment of goods, e-variable generated for moment of goods should be produced. Should be what my difference? Produced. Should be what my difference? Produced. Else, else delivery shall not be given by railways. Else delivery shall not be given by railways, my dear friends. Come on, sir. Very interesting point. I'll read out once again what I wrote. At the time of delivery, at the time of what, sir? Delivery. At the time of delivery, e-variable generated for movement of goods should be produced. Else delivery shall not be given by railways. Come on, write that point. Very interesting. Very, very interesting point, friends. Come on, please do write. Clear? Done? Can I proceed? Very good. Now, my dear friends, an interesting point, let me tell you very clearly. Information in part B. We all know that there is something called part A and part B. Part B contains GST details and other details. Part B contains the vehicle details. Correct, my dear friends? Speak out. Exactly. Information in part B may not be furnished. What is the language used there? Information in part B may not be furnished for a distance up to 50 kilometers within the state or UT. May not be furnished for distance up to what, my difference? For distance up to 50 kilometers within the state or UT. Within the state or UT from place of business of consignor, from place of business of what, sir? Consignor to place of business of transporter, to place of business of transporter for transportation. Come on, my dear friends. Place of business of what, sir? Place of business of consignor to place of business of transporter for transportation. Or second scenario also is there. Place of business of transporter, place of business of what, my dear friends? Transporter. Place of business of transporter. Finally, place of business of what, sir? Transporter. Finally, to place of business of, to place of business of consignee, my dear friends. To place of business of consignee. So what is the language used, sir? Information in part B, information in part B may not be furnished for distance up to how much? Up to 50 kilometers within the state or UT from place of business of consignor to place of business of transporter for transportation, or place of business of transporter finally to place of business of what? Consignee. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Very, very interesting points. No doubt about it. And next point, very, very interesting point, my dear friends. Listen, listen, my dear friends. Once e-variable is generated, once e-variable is what, my dear friends? Generated, a unique, otherwise, an unique EBN, that is e-variable number, is made available. Is made what, sir? Available to supplier, comma recipient, to supplier, recipient, and transporter. It will be made available to whom, sir? To supplier, recipient, as well as transporter. Very, very interesting line, my dear friends. To supplier, recipient, and transporter. I hope you are getting clarity on this point. Very, very, very interesting point, my dear friends. Speak out. Exactly. Very good. Now, if there is a change in conveyance, there is a change in conveyance during the course of transit. If there is a change in conveyance during course of what, sir? Transit. Maybe because, for example, goods have started going from Telangana to Karnataka, but in the course of journey there was a breakdown and that lorry is not starting at all, lorry is not working at all, then what we'll do, my dear friends? We'll bring another conveyance and shift the goods to another conveyance and take it. And if there is a change in conveyance during course of transit, then details of part B, obviously, because part B only contains conveyance detail, part B should be updated. Since details mentioned in part B should match, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, details mentioned in what, my dear friends? Details mentioned in part B should match with actual vehicle number. When vehicle is intercepted by the officer, and when I say intercepted, that means what? He will stop the vehicle and start checking. And when he stops the vehicle and start checking, that time, when he stops the vehicle and start checking, what he will do is actually, he will check part B and check what is the vehicle number. Very good. And then he will see there what is the vehicle number. If both are same, he's okay. But if both are different, then he will start telling, you are trying to smuggle the goods. Come on, please pay penalty now. Not normal, guys. Extraordinary concept. Come on, please, like this. And this concept is very, very important. Come on, friends. Done right? Finished writing? It's a very interesting language, guys. Something which actually makes a lot of sense. Clear, right? Done. Now, one very interesting point I'll tell you, sir. In case of build-to-ship-to model, I'm sure we know this word called build-to-ship-to model. What is build-to-ship-to model? Goods are supplied by supplier to the recipient on the instructions of third person. There are three parties involved there. Correct, my difference? In case of what? Build-to-ship-to model. Example, let's say there is somebody called P, somebody called Q, somebody called R. be instructed. Q, be instructed, what my difference? Q to send the goods to R. Be instructed Q to send the goods to what my difference? R. And technically, in this kind of transactions, there are always two inverses. Why two inverses? Inverse number one is from Q to B. Inverse number two is from P to R. Obviously, because R can't ask inverse from Q, because R doesn't know who Q is and Q doesn't know who R is. Q is sending goods to R. I repeat one more time. Q is sending goods to R only upon the instructions of P. If not, Q doesn't know who is R and R doesn't know who is Q. Very clear cut point, my dear friends. Make sense, right? In this case, what they told is, in this case, only, in this case, only one e-label is sufficient. In this case, only one e-label is sufficient. In this case, only what my difference? One e-label is sufficient, which can be generated either by P or Q. Only one e-label is sufficient, which can be generated either by P or what my difference? Q. Only one e-label is sufficient and which can be generated either by what my difference? P or by Q. Either P can generate or Q can generate, but one e-label is sufficient, no doubt about it. Very, very interesting point, and of course important point. This point came in exam on time for a multiple choice question. For build to shift to model, how many e-labels are required to be generated? Very clearly, one e-label is enough. Come on, take this point. Clear, friends? Come on now. I hope we wrote this point, build to ship to model. So I'm just waiting so that you can just take down some points that, and they are very interesting, on which you can't take chance at all. Clear, my dear friends? Come on. Next very interesting point. If transporter transports, obviously transporter will transport only. If transporter transports multiple consignments, if a transporter transports multiple consignments in a single conveyance, come on my dear friends, if a transporter transports what my difference? Multiple consignments in a single conveyance, that's very much possible. That means there is one transporter and the transporter is carrying goods belonging to you, belonging to me, and belonging to different persons. Then what transporter can do is, then transporter, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, if transporter transport multiple consignments in a single conveyance, then transporter can generate consolidated e-label. What e-label, my dear friends? Consolidated e-label in form GST EWB 02, indicating serial numbers. Indicating what, my dear friends? Serial numbers of e-labels generated. Indicating serial numbers of e-labels generated by person causing movement of goods. E-label generated by person causing movement of goods. Very clear cut point, my dear friends. Something very interesting and important point. If transporter transports what, my dear friends? Multiple consignments. I'll highlight that word, multiple consignments in a single conveyance. Then he can do something called, he can generate consolidated EV bill. And that consolidated EV bill he will generate in a form called from GST EWB 02, indicating serial numbers of EV bill generated by person causing movement of goods. Clear, my dear friends? Everyone, come on, please write this point. Extremely important. Please take it. No relaxation. Please, kindly, please do write. Something very, very important, my dear friends. No doubt about it. Done. Can I proceed? Come on. Next point, my dear friends. E-way bill, once generated, it cannot be modified, my dear friends. We cannot modify the E-way bill. That's not possible at all. E-way bill, once generated, cannot be modified. However, it can be, however, my dear friends, it can be cancelled, sir. I repeat one more time, my dear friends, we cannot modify the e-way bill, but however, it can be what, my dear friends? However, it can definitely be cancelled within 24 hours. Within how many hours, my dear friends? Very, very important point. Within 24 hours of generation of E-way bill, within 24 hours of generation of E-way bill, my dear friends, very, very interesting and wonderful point. E-way bill, once generated, it cannot be modified. However, it can definitely be cancelled within 24 hours of generation of E-way bill. And important point to be noted is that E-way bill cannot be cancelled. E-way bill cannot be what, my dear friends? Cancelled if it has been, if it has been verified in transit. That means during movement of goods, this E-way bill is already checked, my dear friends. Then there is no question of cancellation of E-way bill. Getting clarity, my dear friends? And moreover, an interesting point to be noted is that, further, an interesting point to be noted is that unique E-way bill number generated, unique E-way bill number is generated, is valid. Unique E-way bill number generated is valid for 15 days for updation of Part B. That means once Part A is filled, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, once Part A is filled, Part B can be filled within 15 days. I repeat one more time, my dear friends, once Part A is filled, Part B can be filled within 15 days. That is an interesting point, what you should make note of. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Very, very interesting point. Friends, come on, please do write down. I'm just waiting for you. So please do write. No relaxation, please. Something extremely important and super duper wonderful concept on which we can't take any chance. So please do write. And next point, what I'm going to talk with you is something extremely important and super duper important concepts. That is the story of validity of e-way bill. That means how long the e-way bill is valid. How long the e-way bill is valid. And for that, they clearly told based on distance, my dear friends. Based on what, sir? Distance, they told. And what is the interesting point you should know very clearly is that distance, if the distance is up to 100 kilometers, my dear friends, distance up to how many kilometers, sir? 100 kilometers. The validity period is only 1 day. I repeat one more time. If the distance is up to 100 kilometers, my dear friends, the validity period is 1 day. And for every 100 kilometers, for every what, sir? 100 kilometers or part thereof, thereafter, for every 100 kilometers or part thereof, thereafter, you will get something called one additional day. One what day, my dear friends? One additional day is what we will get. Up to 100 kilometers, 1 day, and for every 100 kilometers or part thereof, thereafter, you will get something called one additional day. An interesting special point is that we have got some concept called up to 20 kilometers, it is 1 day. And this is in case of over-dimensional cargo. Over-dimensional cargo is something like, maybe something like petrol tankers or any other kind of vehicles where the size of the tank or size of the background storage is more than the vehicle. Background storage, say space, background storage space is more than the length and breadth of the vehicle. I repeat one more time. Back storage space is more than the length and breadth of vehicle. That is why it is called as over-dimensional cargo. Up to 20 kilometers, 1 day. And for every 20 kilometers, for every 20 kilometers or part thereof, thereafter, for every 20 kilometers or part thereof, thereafter, obviously what I'll get is one additional day. And this point I'm talking only about over-dimensional cargo. So if it is not an over-dimensional cargo, then definitely the story is 100 kilometers. If it's over-dimensional cargo, then the story is 20 kilometers, my dear friends. What kilometers? 20 kilometers. And friends, one interesting point to be noted is that this 20 kilometers point, it will also apply to, it will also apply to multi-modal shipment. Which involves at least one leg, multi-modal shipment, which involves at least one leg by ship. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. It will also apply to multi-modal shipment, which involves at least one leg by ship, my dear friends. That means very clearly the goods are to be transported by 2-3 modes, of which one mode is very clearly ship is there. One of the transport involved in that is ship. That means for some distance it is going by vehicle and some distance it is going by ship. And maybe some distance by air also. That is why it is called multi-modal shipment. And for multi-modal shipment, which involves at least one leg by ship, for that also 20 kilometers point only will apply. So generally it is up to 100 kilometers 1 day, and for every 100 kilometers or part thereof, what, my dear friends, additional day will come. And for over-dimensional cargo or multi-modal shipment, which involves at least one leg by ship, then the story is 20 kilometers, sir. And one interesting point to be noted very clearly is that, which I'll write as a note, validity of e-way bill can be extended further Why you want to extend further? Because generally 100 kilometers they are telling please go within one day, but for some reason the vehicle broke down or there is some other issue, for some reason goods could not reach in one day, validity of e-way bill can be extended further within 8 hours from the time of expiry. So within 8 hours from the time of expiry, you can extend it further. Getting clarity, friends? Good. Very interesting point. Come on, my dear friends. Very, very interesting, important concept. But before you write, I'll tell you something interesting. Then you write, my dear friends. Listen. So whenever I use this word called one day and all, I'll just give a small example. Listen, my dear friends. Let's say, for example, e-way bill generated at 5 p.m. on 10th October 2019. Then, my dear friends, then let me tell you very clearly, then one day will end at 12 p.m. on 11th October. 12 p.m. of what, my dear friends? 11th October. Other words, 12 midnight. Will end at 12, what, my dear friends? Midnight. 12 midnight of 11th October. 12 midnight of what, my dear friends? 11th October. That is a very interesting point, what you have to understand. Clear, my dear friends? Speak out, sir. And another interesting point, let me tell you, my dear friends. Another example, let's say, if e-way bill generated at 4 a.m. on 10th October 2019, then one day, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, then one day will end at 12 midnight of 11th October. Same answer, my dear friends, no change at all. Very, very, very clearly, same answer, my dear friends. That means next day, 12 o'clock, the time will end. Next day, 12 o'clock, one day is over. Getting clarity, my dear friends? Speak out. Otherwise, my dear friends, each day, come on, each day shall be counted. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Each day shall be counted as the period expiring. Each day shall be counted as the period expiring at midnight. As the period expiring at what, my dear friends? Midnight of the day. Of the day. Immediately following the date of generation of e-way bill, my dear friends. Very, very interesting point. I'm pretty sure we got full clarity on this point, my dear friends, especially with the examples what we discussed. Come on, my dear friends, I'll wait for some time. First, take this concept. Very, very important. Please take this, come on. Almost e-way bill is coming to an end, but still a lot more points are there. Come on, please take this. Very, very interesting, very, very important. Take it, my dear friends. Very, very important. This talks about the story of validity of e-way bill, which clearly says that up to 100 kilometers one day, and for every 100 kilometers of part thereof, thereafter, one additional day, and for over-dimensional cargo, and also for multi-modal shipment, which involves at least one leg, of transport by ship. In that cases, it is 20 kilometers. Very, very interesting point. Clear, my dear friends? Come on, next. I hope you finished writing. Done, right? Chalo. So, my dear friends, now kindly take this example and write these points once. Come on. Very, very important. Take these examples. Take the examples, my dear friends. Very interesting and important examples. No doubt about it. Each day shall be counted as period expiring at midnight of the day. I repeat one more time. Each day shall be counted as period expiring at the midnight of the day immediately following the date of generation of what, my dear friends? E-way bill. Make sense, right? Done. Very interesting. Take that two examples. Something super duper interesting and amazing concept. No doubt about it. Finish. Can I proceed? Done, my dear friends. Let me move forward now. Come on. Can I finish writing? Important, friends. Important. No games at all. Something extremely important and wonderful points. Clear? Done. Next point, my dear friends. E-way bill generated by one party. One party means generally the supplier will be available to other party for acceptance or rejection. That means other party can accept the e-way bill or other party can reject the e-way bill. Correct, my dear friends? Now, interesting point is that if there is no response, from other party, there is no response from other party within 72 hours, that means technically within 3 days, if there is no response from other party within 72 hours, then what will happen, my dear friends? Obviously, what will happen? Then it is deemed to be accepted. What, my dear friends? Accepted. Come on, write this point. E-way bill generated by one party will be available to the other party for acceptance or rejection. And if there is no response, one more time I repeat. If there is what, my dear friends? If there is no response from other party within 72 hours, then it shall be deemed to be accepted. Very, very interesting and important point. Please write down. I'm sure we got full clarity on all these points, my dear friends. Very, 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 very interesting points. I still have few small points to talk. With that, I can happily complete this concept of e-label. Come on, let me discuss those. Clear, friends? Next line. Next point, my dear friends. Person in charge of the conveyance, that means technically in case of a lorry, the driver, person in charge of the conveyance must carry invoice or bill of supply or delivery challan and also physical copy of e-label. Physical copy of what, my dear friends? E-label. One more time, I repeat, sir. Physical copy of what? E-label or e-label should be mapped to, or e-label should be mapped to RFID. I repeat one more time, sir. E-label should be mapped to RFID in the conveyance. Now, an interesting point what you will ask is, sir, what is this word called RFID? RFID stands for Radio Frequency Identification Device. This is something like a GPS facility. What is GPS? Global Positioning System. And why do we use that GPS, my dear friends? For the purpose of tracking movement. Whenever we take Ola or Uber and go in that cab, we get that tracking number because GPS is installed, a chip is installed. In the same way, even for vehicle also, RFID will be there, Radio Frequency Identification Device, for the purpose of tracking movement of goods. Where are the goods going? Clear? Done? Next. PO may, upon authorization, PO may upon what, my dear friends? Authorization, can intercept any conveyance. What he can do, my dear friends? He can any time intercept any conveyance to verify the, he can intercept any conveyance to verify the, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, he can intercept any conveyance to verify the documentary evidences. I repeat one more time, my dear friends, he can intercept any conveyance to verify the documentary evidences. Clear, my dear friends? And They may also have RFID readers, my dear friends. RFID readers is something like Radio Frequency Identification Device readers. Like how for a product, if there is a barcode, they will scan that barcode in supermarkets. Like how a product, if it has a barcode in supermarkets, they will scan that barcode. In the same manner, here also, when there is an RFID, when there is a number, the number mapped to RFID, with RFID reader, they'll get the information. They'll get the information straight away. Clear, my difference? Makes sense, right? Come on, write that point. And one point very clearly, my dear friends, upon inspection, PO should, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, upon inspection, PO should, one more time I repeat, upon inspection, PO should prepare a summary report and submit online within 24 hours of inspection. Everything has now become online, my dear friends. No doubt about it. PO should prepare a summary report and submit online within 24 hours of inspection. Moreover, I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Moreover, final report to be submitted. Come on, my dear friends. Moreover, final report should be submitted within 3 days of inspection. So for summary report, what, my dear friends? 24 hours. But for final report, they told within 3 days of inspection. Very clear cut point, my dear friends. Makes sense, right? Come on. Now, my dear friends, one interesting point you have to know is that 24 hours or 3 days shall be counted. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. 24 hours or what, my dear friends? 3 days shall be counted from the midnight. 24 hours or 3 days shall be counted from what, my dear friends? Shall be counted from midnight. Midnight of the date. Midnight of the date on which, I repeat one more time, my dear friends, 24 hours or 3 days. 24 hours or 3 days shall be counted. 24 hours or 3 days shall be counted from the midnight. From what, my dear friends? From the midnight of the date on which, from the midnight of the date on which vehicle was intercepted. Vehicle was what, my dear friends? Intercepted. And more specifically, one more point they told is that the set period of 3 days. 3 days is for what? 3 days is for final report. The set period of 3 days may be extended for another maximum 3 days. The set period of 3 days may be extended for another maximum 3 days by commissioner or any officer authorized by commissioner. Come on, my dear friends. Very, very interesting and important concept. No doubt about it. Please take this point. Come on. Upon inspection, PO should prepare what, my dear friends? Summary report and submit online within 24 hours of inspection. Moreover, a final report they have to submit within 3 days of inspection. And the 24 hours and 3 days shall be counted from midnight of the date on which vehicle was intercepted. So we'll start counting that only from midnight. We'll count from what, my dear friends? Midnight of the date. We'll count from what? Midnight of the date on which vehicle was intercepted. Very much clear point, my dear friends. No doubt about it. Will count from midnight of the date on which vehicle was intercepted. And the set period of 3 days may be extended for another maximum 3 days by whom, my dear friends? Commissioner or any officer authorized by commissioner. That's it. Clear this point, my dear friends? Very interesting and very important point. Now next to see. Next point, my dear friends, listen very clearly. If a vehicle has been intercepted and detained, when I say detained, intercepted means what? Stopped. Detained means taken custody. The proper officer has taken custody because he found that there is a contravention, that documents are different, goods are different, or e-vehicle is not proper, or something is fishy, something is wrong. If a vehicle has been what, my dear friends? Intercepted and detained for a period exceeding 30 minutes. Come on, my dear friends. If a vehicle has been intercepted and detained for a period exceeding 30 minutes, my dear friends. If the vehicle has been intercepted and detained for a period exceeding, what, my dear friends? 30 minutes. Then, the details to be uploaded online. Then the details to be uploaded, what, my dear friends? Online. Come on, write that point. So whenever vehicle is stopped like that and detained for a time period of more than 30 minutes, then the details to be uploaded online. And basically the transporter can upload online, saying that, boss, it's detained for more than 30 minutes. What is this nonsense? Complete the work as soon as possible, because everything is perfect. And if something is wrong, then definitely they'll ask you penalty. And I clearly told you what is the penalty also. If he comes forward, 100% of tax. And if he doesn't come forward, then penalty is 50% of value. Section 129, detention, seizure and release of goods and conveyance in transit. Clear, my dear friends? Something very interesting and very important points. I hope we are clear with all these points, my dear friends. Friends, these are all the very, very interesting points what we have got in relation to the concept of e-way bill. But one, two small points are there to talk. That is basically, what are the kind of cases where e-way bill is not required? I mean, that is more from a knowledge standpoint. But if I discuss that, then the story of e-way bill is completely done. So let's discuss that. What are the cases and scenarios where e-way bill is not required, my dear friends? Let's look at that document, my dear friends. Come on, please see that. Come on, my dear friends. The last discussion in relation to the concept of e-way bill, that is the cases where e-way bill is not required, specified goods that are exempt from e-way bill rules. And this is more from a knowledge standpoint. So kindly please look at that, my dear friends. Something very interesting. I mean, the possibility of exam may or may not coming, I cannot guarantee. But still, from a knowledge standpoint, it's very interesting and important, friends. Clear? Come on, see now. First, transportation of those goods laid down in the annexure to rules as specified below. Clear, friends? What is that? Come on. Liquefied petroleum gas, nothing but LPG, for supply to household and non-domestic exempted category customers. So what is covered is only liquefied petroleum gas for supply to what? For supply to household and non-domestic exempted category customers, not taxable category customer. Then, kerosene sold under PDS. When I say PDS, it talks about public distribution system. Clear, my difference? Then, postal baggage transported by Department of Post. Then, natural or cultured pearls and precious or semi-precious stones, precious metals and metals clad with precious metal. Getting clarity, friends? Next line. Jewelry, goldsmith and silversmith wares and other articles. So for gold items, jewelry items and all, there is no need for e-way bill. Then currency, used personal and household effects. I'll highlight that word, my dear friends. It is used personal and household effects. Then unworked and worked coral. Coral, we know, right? Inside the sea we find these corals. Exactly. Then next line, my dear friends. Come on, let's look at that next point. Goods being transported, I repeat one more time, goods being transported are alcohol, liquor for human consumption, petroleum crude, high speed diesel, petrol, natural gas, aviation turbine fuel. So these are actually not covered in GST law. So there is no point of e-way bill also. Next, goods being transported are not treated as supply under Schedule 3, my dear friends. Schedule 3 talks about transactions which are neither regarded as supply of goods nor regarded as supply of service. Then, goods transported are empty cargo containers. When it's empty containers, cargo containers, there is no need for e-way bill, guys. Then, goods other than de-oiled cake being transported are specified in notification 2/2017, and those goods are curd, lassi, buttermilk, fresh milk and pasteurized milk not containing added sugar or other sweetening matter, vegetables, fruits, unprocessed tea leaves and unroasted coffee beans, live animals. When you transport animals, there is no need for edible plants and trees, meat, cereals, unbranded rice and wheat flour, salt, items of educational importance like books, maps, periodicals. Friends, one point is very clear that it's not mandatory that you have to remember all these points. But the reason I'm discussing all these points is only to make sure that we get a clarity of thought on what are the cases where e-label is not required. Next, goods exempted notification 7/2017. What is that? Supply by CSD. Sir, CSD basically stands for Canteen Stores Department. This is basically canteen, what we find, something like army canteens, something like that. Supply of goods by Canteen Stores Department to unit run canteens and authorized customer. We know that, right? For army people, we have got one separate canteens provided for the army category persons. Goods exempted, supplied by CSD to unit run canteen and authorized customer. Then other one, heavy water and nuclear fuels. What fuels, my dear friends? Nuclear fuels. Here we are talking about something like supply of heavy water and nuclear fuels. Supply of heavy water and nuclear fuels by Department of Atomic Energy. I repeat one more time, my dear friends. Supply of what, sir? Supply of heavy water and nuclear fuels by Department of Atomic Energy. So nuclear, my dear friends, come on. Nuclear bombs. Department of Atomic Energy to Nuclear Power Corporation Limited. To Nuclear Power Corporation. To Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited. Come on, my dear friends. Supply of heavy water. Supply of what, sir? Heavy water and nuclear fuels by Department of Atomic Energy to Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited. Getting clarity, friends? Done. In these cases, there is no need to generate e-way bills, sir. Some more points to be noted is other transactional cases. See that, come on. Other transactional cases where e-way bill is not required. Come on, my dear friends. Number one, e-way bill is optional for goods of value less than 50,000, except in case of mandatory e-way bill provisions like movement of handicraft goods and interstate job work. We know that their e-way bill is mandatory. That was the starting first point, what I clearly taught in the concept of e-way bill. Second point, very, very, very important and very practical also. If goods are being transported by a non-motorized conveyance, by what conveyance, my dear friends? Non-motorized conveyance. Example, horse carts or manual carts. Practical example, my dear friends, there was a time when in the initial days where they clearly told in the law, e-way bill is mandatory. There was huge traffic on the e-way bill site and people were not able to access the e-way bill website and generate e-way bill. So in Punjab, some people, what they have done is through horse cart, bullock carts, they started making movement of goods. And if officers stopped, they bluntly told there is no need to generate e-way bill because this is a horse cart or a bullock cart. Clear, friends? Next line. Next point. If the goods are being transported from port, airport, air cargo complex and land custom station to inland container depot or container freight station for clearance by customs. It is something like goods are being sent from port or airport to inland container depot. Inland container depot is a place where the goods are being stored. Generally from airport or port, they take this to inland container depot and there they segregate all the goods. Or from inland container depot or container freight station to customs port, airport, air cargo under customs bond, or from one customs port or station to another one under customs bond, and goods transported under customs supervision or customs seal. Very interesting. Next line. goods transported within notified areas. Notified areas is what the state government or union territory, they will frame for this notified areas. It is not required. Then next point, goods transported are transit from or to Nepal or Bhutan. They are basically transit cargo from Nepal or Bhutan or to Nepal or Bhutan. Sixth point, very interesting and important. Kindly please see that, my dear friends. If the goods are transported to a weighbridge, so what is a weighbridge? Weighbridge is a place where we take our lorry or the vehicle for the purpose of weighing the quantity in that, or weighing the weight of that goods being there in that particular lorry or vehicle. Come on, if the goods are transported to a weighbridge within 20 kilometers, if the goods are transported to a weighbridge within 20 kilometers and back to the place of the business by being covered under delivery challan. So it's within 20 kilometers and that too it's under cover of delivery challan. Seventh point, government kept that point for their own self. Where government or local authorities transport goods by rail as a consignor, government or local authorities are transporting the goods. Then goods transported are to or from Ministry of Defense. For defense, definitely exemption is given. And last point, my dear friends, where empty cylinders, what is that word, sir? Empty cylinders for packing of LPG, what is LPG? Liquefied petroleum gas, are being moved for reasons other than supply. That's it, my dear friends. This is the story of this wonderful concept called concept of e-waybill, which is very clearly dealt by one excellent rule called Rule 138, which is extremely important and super duper important and wonderful, my dear friends. And high possibility that a question can trigger in the exam. At all said and done, this is very practical and very, very important. And I strongly believe that we have got full clarity on this concept of e-waybill. Clear, friends? Wonderful. Thank you so very much. Take care. Balance will take forward in next session, my dear friends. Thank you. Bye-bye. Take care.